Well, it's great to be with everyone here in Neepawa, and we practice this. I'm going to say hi to Portage, and we know what to do. Hello, Portage. Thanks for joining us. That was good. That was way more enthusiastic, honestly, than Portage. You've kind of been getting weak over the last few years, so may that challenge you. We have here, obviously, our Neepawa church, but it's kind of exciting because we've got a contingent from Dauphin, and you know, in Portage, we've been talking about maybe Dauphin as our next church, and just to kind of let you know, we're excited about going to try to get funding with partnering with our district like we did for the Neepawa Church. We're going to go have that meeting in June, and then we're also looking at a couple that are currently pastoring elsewhere that are feeling like maybe they're led to come up to Dauphin. So these are moving from the stage of dreaming to deciding, and it's still kind of in that process, but there's reason to be excited about what God is doing there. So how cool is it to be a year and a half in here in Neepawa and already imagining God doing some of the things in that town that he's been doing here and has been in Portage for years. So that's awesome. Let me pray, and then we're going to get into our message. Father, thank you for the gift of Jesus and in this season as we move to Easter. And in so many ways are anticipating in our lives that day when you say it is finished and the sorrow is done and we are resurrected. As much as we anticipate that, may you show us today how to live in the power of that now, optimistically, with strength, adding life to the people around us. In Jesus' name, amen. So, I'm not a bad hockey player. 40 years old, but I can keep up with the young guys, especially if they're kind of overweight young guys, then I have more of a chance. And sometimes, like last Thursday, because my hockey team is in the playoffs, and I'm chasing a guy who's 25, and I'm keeping up, I sort of have this false if only moment, right? If only I hadn't stopped playing hockey when I was about 8 years old, and really missed some formative years, because I think they're formative years. Between 8 and 18 is probably pretty formative for a hockey player. I missed those years. And now I'm kind of back in it, and I'm playing against some of these guys that did junior A in college, and I feel like, I don't want to ever watch game tape, but I feel in my head like I'm keeping up. And I have an if only moment. Like, if only my parents had pushed me in this, if only when I had said, no, you know what, this is just kind of taking so much time, if only they had wanted me to dive into it a little bit more, if only, then I would be something. Now, I realize, like, at that age, I was like 140 pounds and 6'2". Not a lot of pro hockey players have that body type, but my if only still kind of is dangling there. And I was talking to somebody whose if only was along these lines. If only my family had valued education more, because I actually had a pretty good mind. And if they had pushed me and even opened those doors, then I might have been able to go on to university and do some things. If only they had valued the arts in my family instead of sports, because I was more poet than baseball player, and I swung the bat, you know, awkwardly for years and years if they had just empowered me. So we have these if-onlys in our lives, and I think part of being human is to have them, and you just end up having to sort out how to leave those behind, in a sense, so you can live the life that you have. What's interesting for Christians is that our if-onlys, they get a direction to them. So if you're not a Christian, you may have an if-only, like, if only my dad didn't drink so much, right? If only he had been present, if only. So that's the regret of someone who doesn't have Christ in their life. Somebody who has Christ in their life, it's even more poignant, because your if-only has a direction. If only Jesus had done something about my dad drinking. So if somebody dies in your life that early on, and you miss out on their influence, a mother or a grandfather, oh, if only they had been around, I'd love to talk to them. Or if onlys as Christians, they end up being like, if only Jesus had done what we believe he can do, and we know he loves us, why is it like this? So if only my grandpa hadn't died, then my son Soren would have gotten to know him, and they would have loved each other, because they're both kind of built like fire hydrants, and they look like each other, and if only God had saved him from the dementia and the slow decline that eventually he died. And my grandma, now 15 years later, is still here. Why that? So it's not just if only my grandpa, it's if only God. And so for Christians, as we look at these if onlys, we look at them with like a little more direction, because we know who to look at. It's not this nebulous, oh, if only this had turned out. It's like, if only God had done the sort of things that seem to be in line with his character, then maybe our lives would be different. In the text we're going to look at this morning, we have really three people saying, if only. And they get to say it directly to Jesus' face. Two people say, if only, and then a third group of people kind of say, sort of, if only. It's not quite those words, but it's the same. It's the gist is the same. And Jesus' response is very interesting, and I want to warn you up front, it's not entirely satisfying. So what we're not going to find this morning is an answer to our if onlys. But here's what this text does for me with my if onlys, particularly the ones that I directed Jesus. What this story does is it doesn't give me an answer to the if onlys, but it gives me hope that someday there will be the kind of answer that satisfies. Okay, so it doesn't give me the answer. I can't quite comprehend everything that's happening in this text, but it gives me hope that there will be an answer to my if onlys, and of course my prayer is that it does the same for us here. So let's get into the text together. John 11, 1-45. A man named Lazarus was sick. He lived in Bethany with his sisters Mary and Martha. Important here to notice, because we're going to move into a story about suffering, that suffering for Jesus, and in this text, doesn't just have a certain person somewhere was sick. These people have names, brothers and sisters. Suffering always has a name, right? There's generic suffering that doesn't really touch our lives, and then there's the stuff where the names are there, and sometimes those names come back to us in haunting ways, or they come back to us in like nice memory ways, but suffering always has a name. I've got two sisters. Like Lazarus, I have a sister named Erin and a sister named Sally. Sally is like 6'2". She's very tall. Erin is not. And Erin's not watching. Sally probably is, so I just got away with something there. And so I wonder about birth order in this story, because I'm the oldest, and so I have a middle sister, Erin, who's 3 years younger than me, and then Sally, 6 years younger. I know some of the dynamics, how we played together, how that shook down. Is Lazarus the old one? Is he like the protector? Has he always been? Is he the middle child? Or is he like little Lazarus? Did he kind of come along later, and the sisters are... So we're invited here to think about Lazarus, Mary, and Martha, in the same way that we would think about Nathan, Erin, and Sally as Sally, as people who have real lives that intersect with Jesus. Jesus knows them by name, like us. So the two sisters sent a message to Jesus, telling him, "Lord, your dear friend is sick." Just zip me through to verse 4. But when Jesus heard about what he said, heard about it, so he's heard about the sickness, he says, "Lazarus' sickness will not end in death. No, it happened for the glory of God, so that the Son of God will receive glory from this." So although Jesus loved Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, he stayed where he was for the next 2 days. So now here we start to wonder, there's some tension that ought to be introduced into this text. Why do you, when you love somebody, you would prolong their suffering? Yeah, I get it. Lazarus is sick. I do love them. I'm just going to kick around here for a couple days because this is going to result in glory. Seems a little bit callous. It's something that ought to grab us and have us wonder, especially when he's like, it's going to be about the glory of God. What does he mean by the glory of God? There's two understandings of what the glory of God might be. One is, and this is a spoiler alert if you don't know the story, Lazarus is going to have a miracle happen in his life. It's going to be awesome. So it could be about that. It could be about this miracle. And then that glory would be like how everyone cheers when Jesus does something. Yay, we give glory to God. There's the glory. But it could very well be that the glory here is about where Jesus is going. Because Jesus' choice to go back to Judea, and we'll see it in a section a little bit later, takes him back to a place where there's people who want to kill him. He's taking a step closer to death here. And so the big picture glory is the glory of the one who's going to take death on himself so that it brings life to somebody else. In that case, the glory is just what he does. It's the glory of the cross, him taking death on himself. It's not that he performs for us and we cheer. It's just who he is. So there's those two types of glory. 2 days go by. Finally, he said to his disciples, let's go back to Judea. But his disciples objected. Rabbi, they said, only a few days ago the people in Judea were trying to stone you. See, we had mentioned that. They're going to kill him if he goes back there. Are you going to go there again? Jesus replied, there's 12 hours of daylight every day. During the day, people can walk safely. They can see because they have the light of this world. But at night, there's danger of stumbling because they have no light. Then he said, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but now I'm going to go wake him up. The disciples said, Lord, if he's sleeping, well, he's going to get better. And we know that, right? Fever breaks, somebody can finally rest, and we're happy about that because it means they're on the mend. They thought Jesus meant Lazarus was sleeping, but Jesus meant Lazarus had died. So he told them plainly, Lazarus is dead. I was reflecting on how, even in my lifetime, how we've talked about death has changed, the words we use. So I remember the first people in my life that were significant that died. When my mom and dad told me about it, that person died. This is the words they use, they have died. Then we started to pass away. And now we just pass. And you can see us wrestling here with this finality of death. So death is like done. Passed away is like softer. And then past is like just trying to keep them here. The problem is, for us, that's just a language game. That's just us trying to soften something that can't be softened by calling it something different. I love here that when Jesus calls it something different, falling asleep, the words he uses actually fit what it is for him. For Jesus, it is simply just falling asleep. So he's not trying to make it soft here. He's just saying, as far as I'm concerned, this is actually what's happened. He's only fallen asleep. Of course, they don't understand, and he has to clarify using their words, but Jesus' word is falling asleep. He continues, and for your sakes, I'm glad I wasn't there, for now you'll really believe. Come, let's go see him. Thomas, nicknamed the twin, said to his fellow disciples, let's go to and die with Jesus. So they have this sense, death is waiting. Jesus is making a choice to go somewhere, to do something for somebody that's going to result in his death. This twin language here is interesting. It's his nickname, the twin. This is Doubting Thomas. Commenters wonder why he's a twin. Did he have a twin? Others think that of the disciples, maybe he's the one who tried the hardest to look like Jesus, have his mannerisms. He was like Jesus Jr. So they called him the twin, which we don't know that, but it's kind of a neat thought. It helps us balance kind of the doubting label that he's been stuck with for a while. It's nice to think of him as the twin. So off they go to Bethany, down the road a few miles from Jerusalem. Now we're in verse 17, pardon me, because we got to catch this part. When Jesus gets there, Lazarus has been in his grave for 4 days. If you have a particularly strong stomach and don't mind this sort of thing, Google what happens to a human body in the first 48 hours. It's not pleasant. And so you can put the aqua velva on and the Old Spice, and you can wrap them so that your last memory is of a decent smell. But the aqua velva is going to wear off really fast as the person, well, I won't get into it. It's just not good. So 4 days later, this is not somebody who's, you know, if we just unwrapped him, he'd look pretty good. He's at a state of putrefaction, decomposition. It's not good. Bethany was only a few miles down the road from Jerusalem. And many of the people had come to console Martha and Mary in their loss. When Martha got word that Jesus was coming, she went to meet him, but Mary stayed in the house. There's no way Mary could have known. I mean, we know Mary from other places. She, and we'll see later, she just runs to him and throws herself at his feet. So Martha, it's almost like Martha heard it first, and she's like, I don't want to tell Mary because I want Jesus to myself for just a few seconds. So Martha goes to Jesus. Lord, if only, this is the first, if three if onlys. If only you had been here, my brother would not have died. We talked a little bit at the beginning of my talk about what we might have in that blank. If only, Lord, you had stopped the drinking or making me like a little more aware of what I was getting into when I accepted the proposal and now I'm stuck. Lord, if only you had talked to me louder, I could have avoided all this stuff. And right, this is an ache just spoken out loud. Lord, if only you'd been here, my brother wouldn't have died. Some of our versions of Jesus is that he would get angry at this moment, right? Who are you to question me? Doesn't come across that way in this text really anywhere. There's emotion from Jesus, but it doesn't seem like he's hard on these two. Let's continue. Martha's still talking. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask. So she's got some faith there. There's a little bit of hope that maybe this isn't the end of the story. And Jesus says, yeah, this isn't the end of the story. Your brother will rise again. Yes, Martha says, he will rise when everyone else does at the last day. So this is funeral talk, right? Christian funeral talk. Sometimes we don't say the if only, but we feel it. Jesus loved this person. If only that love kind of took on a practical form, we wouldn't be here. But we know he'll rise again someday. So there's this agony and then this like really still wanting to trust Jesus with good reason. Jesus continues, I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone who believes in me will live even after dying. Everyone who lives in me and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this, Martha? Yes, Lord, she told him. I've always believed you're the Messiah, the Son of God, the one who's come into the world from God. Sort of episode one, first if only. Martha goes back. She returns to Mary, verse 28. She returned to Mary. She called Mary aside from the mourners and told her, the teacher's here. It's Jesus, and he wants to see you. So Mary immediately went to him. Jesus stayed outside the village at the place where Martha met him. When the people who were at the house saw Mary leave so fast, they assumed she's going to Lazarus' tomb to weep, so they follow her there. When Mary arrived and saw Jesus, she fell at his feet. This is the difference between Mary and Martha. And I worship like Martha. Lord, let's have a talk. Some people worship like Mary. It's like, we don't need words. I'll just fall at your feet. And we kind of learn from each other and in some ways envy each other. But Mary here falls at his feet, as she has like many times before, and says, Lord, again, if only you had been here, my brother would not have died. There's really no way to say that pleasantly, right? We've all been late to grandma's house and she gives us hints, right? Cabbage rolls stay a little bit, right? This would sting. The second if only. When Jesus saw her weeping and saw the other people wailing with her, this is fascinating to me. A deep anger wells up within him, and he's deeply troubled. Let your vision of Jesus, the incarnate God, have room for this anger and this troubledness, this agitation. And the text shifts tone with that emotion. It seems a little less light. It wasn't light to start with, but it finds this new depth. And Jesus gets like terse and abrupt, and he starts barking commands out of this sense of death. It's like, it's almost like he hates death as much as us. But the only emotion we can have is like sadness. He's allowed a whole range because he can deal with it differently. In his emotion, he says, where have you put him? He asked them. And they told him, Lord, come and see. That come and see is fascinating, because who in the book of John have we always been invited to come and see? Jesus. So he's recruiting the disciples. Come and see. And what do you see? Light and life and truth and resurrection and the bread of life and the way. And now here, Lord, come and see death. Oh, it's like showdown language. So the one we come and see to see light and life and truth is now going to come face to face in an interesting way with decay and death and everything that's wrong with the human experience. It's funny. Brilliantly written. Lord, come and see. Next verse. Then Jesus wept. If you're somebody who's like, you know what, I have a hard time memorizing scripture, start here. Nice short verse. You know, you add it on your chart. Memorize two verses today. Jesus wept, John 3:16. It looks good on the stats, if you're keeping stats. Our Savior here, so agitated and so confusing to me because he knows what he's about to do. I mean, the text plants seeds in there that he knows he's going for the glory of God. He's going to wake up Lazarus, and yet he's crying. Like, is he pretending? Just going to put on a good show for these people, really empathize, let them know that I feel it. I'm like, you know, I'm a good pastor. I enter into the pain. Or is there something else? There's got to be something else. And no one knows what it is. Here's some thoughts about what it could be. It could be that this situation reminds him of another one. We don't read much about his dad. Scholars believe his dad passed away. There was plenty of deaths around Jesus where he did not do what he's about to do. And we have every reason to think he could have. So there's some confusion there. And in the same way that when we enter into a situation of sadness, it's not just that situation, it's the weight of every other situation. It's never just the funeral we're at. It's all the funerals we've ever been at. And so there's something here that he's processing, and perhaps it's memory. Perhaps he's remembering an aunt. We know what the infant mortality rate was then. Perhaps he's remembering a little sister, a brother, his mom's tears. I mean, there's a humanity to this that we can't miss. Another thing that might be going on is he's just a little bit frustrated with the people around him, that they don't know who he is, that they haven't, and frustrated with him isn't the right idea, it's just that they're not living in the freedom yet of who he is, of what his presence all means, that at some point there is a day coming when we'll no longer weep about death, and that brings light even to a dark place, and they don't have that yet because they haven't figured it out, so maybe his tears are along those lines. Whatever it is, he's in such a state that people notice, and they sense the genuineness in him, and so they say this in verse 36. The people who were standing nearby said, "See how much he loved him." And then they throw out their "if only." But some said, "This man healed a blind man. Couldn't he have healed Lazarus from dying?" So we've got our sort of third "if only." Why didn't he? Jesus was still angry as he arrived at the tomb. A cave with a stone rolled across its entrance. Again, Jesus kind of barking orders. "Roll the stone aside," Jesus told them. But Martha, the dead man's sister, ever the practical one, protested. "Lord, he's been dead for 4 days. The smell will be terrible." Jesus responded, "Lord, didn't I tell you that you would see the glory of God if you believe?" So they rolled the stone aside. Group of people straining against the stone. What's going on in their minds? Then Jesus looked up to heaven and said, "Father, thank you for hearing me. You always hear me, but I said it out loud for the sake of all these people standing here so that they will believe you sent me." It's funny, we usually discourage each other from what we call triangulation in prayer. You're talking to God, but you're actually secretly sending a message to the person listening, right? We sort of say, "Don't do that. That's just underhanded." So somebody's struggling with, you know, finances. You're like, "Lord, help us all to be wise with our budgets." I mean, people smell that stuff and it's generally offensive. Here, Jesus is sort of sending a message to people and almost like he's apologizing to God. "God, I don't need to say this to you because we are so much on the same page, but I'm just letting people know so that they can put the pieces together of what's happening here." And Jesus' request and his prayer of thank you are like the same thing. Because he's so connected to the Father that he gives thanks for and asks for things at the same time. It's like not separate. Then Jesus shouted, "Lazarus, come out." And so you're Lazarus, and you've fallen asleep. And suddenly you wake up in like the middle of a snap, crackle, pop. There's light and there's heat, and what's decomposed begins to reform. And like us waking up from a dream, you're probably not right away certain where you are. You got these bandages over your head. Why am I tied up? You see a little bit of light. You hear something said to you. You sort of hop out of the dead man came out. Jesus earlier in John has said, the time is coming when the dead will hear the voice of God and live. This one did. His hands and feet bound in grave clothes. I mean, literally, he's like bouncing his way out. Jesus told them, unwrap him, let him go. Many of the people who were with Mary believed in Jesus when they saw it happen. I guess they would. It's funny that others didn't. And so their plan to shut it down, let's kill Lazarus. This is a stupid strategy. Just raised a dead man to life, like let's kill him again. They didn't think that one through. All right, there's our text. And it speaks to our if onlys. If only, you know, in part into our imagination. Here's four things that capture my imagination in here. The first thing I find fascinating is that he asked them to roll the stone away. Like moments before he says, Lazarus, come out. He doesn't say, I'm going to warm you up. Stone. He doesn't Jedi force the stone away. He asks them to move the stone. And some of them think it's stupid because of the stench of what's buried there. This is a good example of what Jesus delights to do. The biblical word for it is co-labor. Jesus does not necessarily do everything on his own in our lives. He invites us to partner with him. And we see it here. And so this stone is fascinating because it makes me wonder what stones in our lives is he saying, roll this sucker away so we can have access to what's behind it. Because if you give me access to what's behind it, then life will come out. And we're oftentimes going, oh, but Jesus, it stinks what I've buried back there. And if I crack that seal, the stench may be overwhelming. And so there's things buried that he's telling us he wants us to excavate and fix together. There's things like forgiveness. No, don't even make me go there with, you know, my old man or my old best friend stood up for me at my wedding and now he's just, could you just fix it, Jesus? And Jesus says, no, we gotta roll that stone away. And then together, we're gonna tackle this. Stafford's talked a little bit about some of the folks here in Neepawa. It's certainly the case in Portage. I imagine it's the case in Dauphin. To really have a vibrant church requires incredible commitment and vulnerability. Generally from people who have tried to be committed and vulnerable before and have gotten burnt really bad. What might be buried behind that stone is a sense of never again. Never again will I be that vulnerable. Never again will I care. Never again will I, because it stunk. And I rolled the stone over it and I cemented it and I put some ferns around it so no one would even see it. And Jesus is saying, no, you gotta roll that thing away. Maybe what stinks is an addiction that is hampering you internally, but people think it's just kind of who you are. It's like a limitation, but you know that if you were truly freed from this thing, and by addiction, I'm not just talking about like booze and porn, I'm talking about gossip. Worry can be a bit of an addiction, control. You've got something tucked back there and you're like, it's manageable because I've blocked the stench. but you have no real sense of how good it would feel if you gave Jesus access to that. And what is dead would emerge as life for you. And you need to see that when the stone is rolled away and Jesus speaks into what is dead and buried, life comes out. You can trust him with that. So what you've got buried, he's saying to you, roll the stone away. Fascinated by that. Second thing that I'm fascinated by in this text is the way that Jesus speaks to things that don't have ears. So when he speaks to Lazarus, it's not like Lazarus is lying there listening. So who's he talking to? It's not like Lazarus's soul, okay, just get back in the body. I mean, that's ugly. Jesus here speaking in this marvelous way that he does sometimes, where he speaks to the created order, and he replicates bread, and he replicates fish, and he says to wind and waves, just stop. And they all go, oh, I know that voice. Some of you have animals, yes? And they're like terrible around other people. And then you walk in, and we have a dog named Penny. My kid's voice to Penny does not have the same authority mine does. Penny doesn't even have to see me. I say, Penny. She immediately goes where she's supposed to go, does what she's supposed to do. There's a response that comes because of authority and mastery. And Jesus here speaks it like on the nano level, the molecular level, to Lazarus's body. And it has no choice but to respond. Life to you, Lazarus. And what is decomposed and degenerated, recognize this as the very voice that called them into being. And they don't have an argument. Things with ears can have arguments because they usually have minds attached. When Jesus speaks directly to that level of reality, there's a shift and a transfer of reality, and it's just fascinating. And it makes me want to beg him and ask him to speak to those things in my life that are frustrating me, that my willpower has not allowed me to get victory over, that my fatigue in certain seasons has not let me rise to the level of victory that I want to, that discouragement has kept me from being properly optimistic, and I want to just say, Jesus, just speak to my bones. Speak to my cells. Speak to my brain matter. Like, just be the Jesus who says, peace be still. I give you that. Hold over my being absolute sway. And then for the people in my life, some people in the church who Sunday after Sunday are coming forward to be prayed for, speak to them in new ways. Like precognitive, supracognitive, past their mind, over top of them. They've already here in submission, just speak to their cells and change the fundamental hardwiring of who they are. And I see him do it here, and it's tantalizing. And I see him do it in scripture, and it's just as mesmerizing. And we're obviously supposed to ask for that sort of thing. And so we do. Our church is characterized by this dream and this prayer for one-touch healing. And that's really what it is, that the voice of Jesus would speak in such ways that bring transformation right now, speaking to things that have no choice. So I'm challenged by that, but not nearly as challenged as I am by the next level. That's how I'm supposed to pray. Oh. See, when I say, in Jesus' name, amen, it doesn't sound like Jesus saying, Lazarus, come out. Jesus, thank you for these potatoes, for the fellowship we're going to enjoy around these tables. In your name, amen. Right? I mean, it would be ridiculous if I was like, potatoes, you have no choice but to be blessed. Fellowship, you will rock. Because every victory is won. Because every enemy has been ultimately defeated. Because Jesus is sitting on the throne. Amen. I mean, you have guests over and you try that one? right? Your kids are holding hands. Dad wings off this nutso prayer. Okay, but we are invited to pray in his name. We are adopted as sons and daughters of God. Jesus goes to his Father and our Father. When we pray in his name, it's a reminder of authority. And so we are to speak to reality in the same way. Cancer, be gone. Dysfunction, just leave. Mental illness, you have just wrecked so much here. You're not allowed to stay by the authority of Jesus. Now, what we're not talking about here is technique. So pray this way, and now look how it's going to work. There are certain patterns to how powerful prayers pray, and we're wise to learn that. But we're talking about intimacy. And here, probably like a relational, physical metaphor is helpful. Every magazine talks about technique. Here's how you can please your spouse or your mate with all these techniques. Most people who know what real life is like technique is of relative importance to intimacy. If you know the person that you're relating to, technique is largely irrelevant. The same here. When you're intimate with the Father in the way that Jesus is, when you have prayed behind the scenes for hours and hours and you have stayed up all night, it's not necessarily, oh, I hope I said the right words for this stuff to happen. It's no, I'm just connected to him. Now, don't let that lack of confidence stop you from praying authoritatively. Oh, geez, I don't pray as much as Jesus. I pray like 20 minutes a week. I better not risk a bold prayer. No, no, your adoption papers aren't up for grabs here. You stand at a place where you can speak with this authority. So begin to do that. And you know what? For some of us, that's the stone we need to roll away, I think. Because we're scared. We've tried that before. And we're like 0 for 10. And then we keep seeing it here. Like, this is what Christians do. And we're scared to go back there. Because it's like where our if-only moments were. So do not be scared. This is how he teaches us to pray. This is who he says we are. Last thing that I'm captivated by is not so much these words, if only, but the words that we're heading to at Easter. It is finished. We're caught between if only and it is finished. And we try to live in the it is finished, and praying like we just talked about moves us towards it as we pull the kingdom in as we're called to. But we know that Lazarus came back to life, and then what happened 30 years later? He died. And if Mary and Martha were still alive, they said, oh, if only Jesus was still here. So Lazarus was resuscitated, and that's nice. He had a nice extension of his life, but even that's a mixed blessing. Anybody ever had a health concern go away, and now you're just like waiting for the next time it comes because you know how much it sucked the first time? Yeah, so there's some victory here for Lazarus, but Mary and Martha are like watching him really carefully. So we're not talking about the resuscitation of if only. We're talking about the resurrection of it is finished. And the resurrection of it is finished does not end with you dying someday and coming back to life. It ends with you entirely new. Some of the ways I love to think about this is the words that we will forget because we haven't used them so long. In the new creation, with a resurrected body, not a resuscitated body, a resurrected body that is untouchable by pain and grief, no more tears. Eventually, no one will have said, ouch, for like a long time. No one will have said, please, please stop. No one would have said, you're hurting me. And we'll maybe reminisce. We'll be like, what did we used to say? Like, I don't remember. One of those things we'll forget. What it ever used to mean is if only. Because we will only and always and forever be living in the reality where it is finished. I'm going to turn it over to the band in Portage and invite you two to come up and lead us here.